I know we're running a little behind. We were down at the law enforcement meeting down in Myrtle Beach with just about everybody, including SLED and Department of Public Safety, Highway Patrol, everybody. And the question is, what happened last weekend? And the answer that I believe is that was an aberration. Those were young fellows. I think they were all men. But they were 17, 18 years old. They were on senior weekend. The first time I heard that, I thought, 17, 18 year old, that doesn't sound senior to me, but it's not seniors, it's young seniors. Not high school. But they were young, and they got a little rowdy. And as you know, there was some hurt people. But some or all of them, most of them, were from North Carolina. They came down to visiting like young people do. But the answer is, what are we going to do? And we will do whatever it takes to be sure it doesn't happen again. And we really do have great law enforcement in this state. And they're highly skilled. A lot of them have been at it a long time, got humans coming in, got old ones still there. But a lot of deep professionalism in that group. And one thing that always helps is it's a theme in South Carolina is everybody knows everybody. Most of us are related to a lot more people than would be in other states. In fact, somebody joked and said, I got a legal question for you. What's that? Said, if you get married in South Carolina and divorced in Georgia, are we still cousins? But we think that was just an aberration. Don't think it'll happen again. But there'll be a greatly enhanced police presence starting tomorrow. And it will continue as long as necessary. Some of it will be highly visible, and other will be not visible at all. And that the residents, visitors, everyone should be assured that whatever it takes to keep our state safe will be done. We do have the resources, and you may see some. The tourism is a big business in this state. And this grand strand, which, as I told the reporters down, I've been coming here all my life. Myrtle Beach, Pawleys, Myrtle's in it, every place in between. In fact, we used to call this Ocean Drive way back when I was a boy. But most states don't have a place like this. Matter of fact, most states don't have much of what we have. And that's what makes us so different and what makes us on a steep incline right now for what I think is going to be the greatest prosperity that our state has ever had. And I'll tell you a little about that because it's fascinating. But one thing to remember is this area with the beaches and the tourism is something that I believe ought to be considered a state resource and not just the responsibility of those who happen to live here. What I mean by that is such things as beach renourishment. In the last 3 years, I guess, I've talked to more businesses coming in from other countries and other states, as well as business people here who want to expand. But there's a theme that runs through all of these big businesses that are looking to come here. And they all understand the obvious assets that we have. One is the technical college system, which is second to none. And as you know, it started in 1961. And most other states don't have anything like that. And some of them that do have sort of blended into a more of a community college system that doesn't turn people out at the end of 2 years with an associate degree or with a certificate. It goes straight to work. We've got people coming out of our technical colleges now. They can go to work and some can get big jobs. We've got 22-year-olds buying houses in South Carolina. A lot of us a lot older than that. They still owe money on taxes, of course. But we have done it right. That's something of many things we've done right. That's one of them. And we have a program called Ready SC. Be amazed you may not have heard of that. What that does is if there is a company, let's some say coming from Canada, as one did just recently, and they want to come and they'll agree that they'll have a permanent presence, that they will hire employees at good wages and they'll provide decent benefits. That is, they're going to be a good corporate citizen. And what do we do? We will actually send people from the technical colleges, they call it Radio SC, and they will go to wherever their plant is, if it's a plant, and they will look and see how they do the work that they do there. And then they will come back here and set up a place in the technical college where the things that they make at that other place can be displayed and worked on by students who want to come to the technical colleges. And they'll be advertising, saying, this company is coming, if you want this kind of job, come on in. And they do the advertising, they do the training, they do all of that, and then provide those workers, if they want to go to work for that company, all that is free of charge. I don't think another state comes close to that, and I hear about that from these companies. Also, our port is going to 52 feet. We've got the money to begin the dredging. I think the dredging will start in October. That is a big, big deal for many of these companies. Some of us don't get to the port very often. Some do, and I'm speaking of the Port of Charleston. We also have on the drawing board Port of Jasper. That's going to be another one. It's going to be terrific, but the Port of Charleston will go to 52 feet at low tide, and that means that these big boats, the post-Panamax, they call them, the Panama Canal has been widened and deepened, and these boats are huge, but right now, they can get in and out of our harbor at high tide, but not low tide. Well, once we deepen, it'll be high tide, low tide, anytime. And we have a lot of what they call lift in our harbor between high and low tide. Several feet of lift in Miami, for example, the tides don't make that much difference, but they do here. We're going to have plenty of water, and they'll all be able to come. One of those big ships came in, I think it was last weekend. It was the OOCL, it stands for Orient Continental Line, I can't remember, France. That's the last part of the name. It had over 13,000 container units on it. I said 13,000 container units that you see on these trucks. And guess what? They loaded some and took some off, all that was supposed to go to Port of Charleston to get on the trucks or get on the rail. And it was 3,091 of those containers that they moved, and they did it in 11 and a half hours, which comes out to 4.5 container units a minute. Now that's, I think, is the fastest in the country. I think we have the fastest turnaround. And more than that, when they take those units off of there, what can they do with them? Well, we have an inland port, we call it. It, where the Norfolk Southern train line runs up north, runs up through Greer, between Greenville and Spartanburg, keeps going, it crosses I-85. What does that mean? That means someone who's expecting some products coming in those containers can have them put on that rail and go to Greer, and they don't have to come from north or south or wherever they're coming from and go 200 miles to Charleston, pick it up, and go 200 miles back. They just pick it up right there, or they just drop it off right there. Enormous advantage. Another one is we've broken ground in Dillon to do the same thing with CSX and I-95. No other state's got that. I think Virginia has one small inland port, mainly for coal, I think. But we have one good one, just, and the volume is just terrific. And we'll have this other one soon. So what are they doing? Y'all know BMW in Greer, do you know how many cars they're producing a year? It's about 450 or 60,000. You know what that is? There's a brand new BMW. It comes off the assembly line up there. Already sold. They don't make them until they're sold. Already sold every 61.7 seconds. That's moving. And we have that kind of speed in the Honda plant over in Timmonsville. One of those new ATV vehicles comes off, I think it's every 51 seconds. I mean, we got it going. Now, what happened today? I was in Columbia, and Siemens, which is one of the biggest companies in the world, started in, see if I can remember, 1847 or something like that, where Ludwig von Siemens and his partner created the European version of the telegraph. Well, now they own everything. 330,000 employees worldwide, they're everywhere. What did they do? They just gave $628 million worth of the high-tech, most advanced, cutting-edge software technology to the University of South Carolina for them to use in their research facilities there to train people how to work on these machines, how to operate the technology, the computers, and all of that. And they go do it like that at the University of South Carolina, be available all over the place. President Pastenius said that is the biggest step that in the history of the university, I think he said in 100 years or something like that. I mean, everybody is coming to South Carolina, and they're coming because of the port, they're coming because of the technical colleges and all the adjuncts that we have to that. They come in because of the Grand Strand, they come in because of the mountains, they come in because of the water, they come because of a solid, a reliable source of tidal, which we have. But the main reason, and this surprised me a little bit, although I agree with them 100%, and these are these big companies. I forgot, we have an apprentice program as well, where we have people in the technical colleges can work in one of these plants. And if the plant is certified by the Department of Labor, has a certain kind of program, then the state of South Carolina gives that employer a $1,000 tax credit for training that student. And we're trying to get the federal government to do the same thing. But what really was interesting to me is all of this is BMW, Boeing, Mercedes, Volvo, Continental, Michelin, everybody. More than that. We got 160 German companies in South Carolina. I think that's a world's record. And they said the reason they come here is because of the people. They said there's something different about the people in South Carolina. And some of them I asked, so what do you mean? He said, well, it's hard to put your finger on it. They're friendly, they work hard, they're smart. But he said it's not unusual. As somebody said, I can always tell when I'm in South Carolina. Don't need a map. I don't need a sign, I know. How you know? Because when I go into the restaurant, in between ordering my meal and getting my ticket, my bill, the waitress will call me honey, sweetie, darling, and so I always know when I'm in the restaurant. So we've got a great story to tell. And I think the only thing that can slow us down is if we get off the track. It's going so good. We've had so much great leadership over the years, people in this room. We have to be sure that we don't have too many regulations, we don't choke ourselves with regulations, and we keep taxes low. We don't mess up the environment, that's why a lot of people come here. We don't destroy the historical sites, that's why some people come here. People come here for all kinds of different reasons. Spoleto, for goodness sake, people come from all over the world. Charleston's been the number one tourist destination in the world a number of times, and in the U.S. even more times. We really do have it all in paradise. And to tell you, to finish up, several years ago, I was at the Capital City Club, which is at the top of one of the big buildings in Columbia, right across from the State House. And the speaker that day was Christy Todd Whitman. You may remember her. She was the governor of New Jersey for 8 years. And then she was the secretary of EPA for 3 under the first George Bush. Anyway, now we were talking about these things that we've just been talking about. And I ended up, we were looking out the window because it's 26 stories up and you can see the beautiful Capitol, all the trees and the grass and the greenery around there, and the university, the horseshoe was right over there. You can see the river when you look a little farther, and you can see all this greenery, the football stadium, just beautiful. And I said, yeah, we really do have it all here, don't we? She says, yes, you do. I hope you don't mess it up. The best way to mess it up is with taxes and regulations. So I've issued an executive order by all my agencies and encouraging the rest of them to go through the regulations. Anything that's counterproductive, flag it, we'll take it out. Anything we need, if we really need it, we'll put it in. But give it the old rotary four-way test and be sure we really do need it. But that's what we're doing. We're trying to be sure that the money that is spent wisely. We're looking way into the future to build the things up that we need to build up. We have education we have to work on, but I have determined in my own mind about what comes first, the chicken or the egg, what comes first, this or that. I believe that it's a job. I believe good work for somebody, if they get up in the morning, got something that they want to do, it pays them some money to do it. I've seen families, I've seen law enforcement, and I know that when you have people that have, they have hope, they have jobs, they're happy, what happens? Domestic violence goes down, criminal behavior goes down, marriages go up, divorces go down, everything gets up. So I think that is the main thing we can change. We can accelerate the great progress that we're experiencing now that's been coming for a number of years in building. But we have an opportunity now to accelerate, to get way ahead of our other states and our neighborhood, and to be sure that we have the choice of the finest businesses that we want to come in and we support our businesses that are here now. So that's my story, and I'm glad to tell it to you. Happy to be with you. I've been coming to the Grand Strand since I was a baby, and I'm not going to quit. I was Carolina born, Carolina bred, and when I die, I'll be Carolina dead.